Dr. Kanupriya, Assistant Professor in Department of Biotechnology, GVM Girls College, Sonipat. Today, we're going to study the topic of the genotoxicity of pesticides. As we all know that we are taking the pesticides in our diet through the vegetables and the crops we are taking into our diets. So technically, we are directly exposed to the pesticides. So here we learn about that how these pesticides are harmful to our health and how it will lead to causing the cancer. So here are the contents. In this, we'll study about the pesticides, the categories of pesticides, occupational exposure, route of their exposure, and to measure the genotoxicity, their metabolism, and finally the conclusion. So what are pesticides? These are the any substances of mixtures or substances which are used to prevent, destroying, repelling or mitigating any insects, rodents, nematodes, fungi or weeds to prepare or to protect our crops so that we can consume it very regularly and quite healthy. Now, the question is that are we only exposed to the pesticides or there are some people who are directly exposed to that? So the people who are directly involved into it, for example, the agriculture people, the transportable people, the maintenance people, the applicators people are directly exposed to such harmful chemicals. The primary route of the exposure to the pesticides, it has three major routes. For example, the first one is inhalation, second is oral, and the third one is dermal. In inhalation, the fumes present in the environment that are taken through the respiratory system get exposed to our system. Secondly, the oral system where we take the pesticides through our diet. And the third one is the dermal process where the people have direct exposure to these chemicals, like when some pores are open of our body and we expose to them, we get directly get attracted to the pesticides. So this slide shows that how our body gets infected with the pesticides, the route of the pesticides, like the inhalation through the food or water, through the absorption through the skin, and it has the two kind of exposure system. First is the chronic exposure and the second is the acute exposure. In the chronic exposure, we have the long-term exposure, we have the long-term symptom shows, and in the acute exposure, we have the short-term durations, like some of the symptoms have been shown even during the short period of time. So for the health hazards, we have like which body parts have been affected by these harmful chemicals. So it includes the central nervous system, eye irritation, liver damages, skin irritation, reproductive effects, and most of it causes cancer. Now, how we can measure the genotoxicity? How can we know that how much damage these chemicals are created in our body? So for this, we have three biomarkers. The first one is biomarker of exposure. The second is biomarker of effect, which has cytogenetic biomarkers and biochemical biomarkers. And the third one is biomarker of susceptibility. Among the biomarkers of exposure, first of all, we have to see that, we have to confirm it, that whether our body is taking the minimum amount of pesticides so that it can create some harmful things into our body. So for that, the toxic agents, they get converted into the metabolites, which is called as the adducts. And these adducts that can be measured through the biomarker of exposure. For example, different techniques we used here to measure these adducts, like the TLC technique, HPLC technique, mass spectrometry, radioimmunoassay, or the ELISA technique. So once we get confirmed that our body has exposed to such pesticides and their metabolites are present in our excretory system, so further we have to go for the biomarkers of effects, which shows that these toxic agents have created some sort of damage to our body, some sort of damage to our cytogenetic level, some sort of damage to our biochemical level. So for this, we have different biomarkers like the chromosomal aberration, micronuclear, sister chromatid exchanges. For the biochemical biomarkers, we have COMET assay, oxidative stress assays, and Ames test. Now, I'll show you one figure where we can see the chromosomal damage created by some of these toxic agents. You can see the chromosomal break through the arrows I have marked, some chromosomal breaks, some chromosomal gaps, which shows that some damage has been created by these toxic chemicals. In the next slide, we have shown the sister chromatid exchanges. As you can see these arrows, these exchanges show the reciprocal exchanges of DNA between the two sister chromatid. As we know, that each chromosome has two chromatids, and when one chromosome get intervened into the second exchange, it shows some kind of damages. As you can even see in the picture that we have some kind of damages have been shown here. So these damages shows that this kind of damage has been created by some kind of toxic agents we are taking into our diet, or we are directly getting exposed to some chemicals which are harmful. The third one is the biomarkers of susceptibility. When it comes to the susceptibility, it means that the genetic level, at our genotype, the individual's genotype, how the individual's genotype will going to react with these chemical agents. So for this, the age factors, the diet factors definitely going to affect. So we're taking the general metabolism of these toxic chemicals, jinko hum xenobiotic bhi bolte hain. So what are these xenobiotic chemicals? These are those agents which cannot be directly degraded by in the environment. With the microorganism, they cannot be degraded directly. So for that, we need some specific enzymes known as the xenobiotic metabolizing enzymes. So for this, we need that. Basically, these has been occurring two phases, the phase one, which is known as the activation, and the second phase known as the conjugation. In the first phase activation, the xenobiotic compounds converted into the reactive intermediate, and in the second phase conjugation, they formed into a conjugate, and ultimately they get come out through the excretion into the urine of the individual. So as I say that the first phase is the activation phase, where the CYP known as the cytochrome P450 family is included, while the second phase in the conjugation where happened in this, the GST called as the glutathione S transferase family has been involved. So for this, the genes we definitely going to study for the xenobiotic metabolizing processes, the CYP family included CYP1A1 gene, CYP21E1 gene, and for the GST we have three variants like the GST M1 gene, T1 gene, and GST P1 gene, which are mostly studied gene for identifying the genotoxicity in pesticides or for any xenobiotic genes. So as I said that susceptibility is the most agent that to know that whether that how the individual will going to react with these harmful chemicals. So if the genes are very much less susceptible to the xenobiotic compound, so the individual will be more prone to the cancer, because these agents, these harmful chemicals will not going to degrade into our body, they get accumulated and they can cause cancer. But those individuals whose genes are actively participated and they get easily degraded the xenobiotic compounds, and they can degrade those harmful chemicals and get easily excreted out through the our excreta. So in conclusion, the pesticide, it is a genotoxic agent as we all know, but this is the most important thing that it has the ability to damage our genetic material. Okay, so individuals generally exposed to the pesticide either directly or indirectly during their lifespan. So we can measure their damage, the genotoxic potential of these pesticides through many assays like the biomarker of exposures or the effects. So, and at last, the genetic factor is very much important, that the individual's genetic makeover, how it will react to those harmful chemicals, that if it is more susceptible, it will cause the more genotoxic damage, and if it is less susceptible, if it causes less genotoxic damage. Thank you.